invite you all to come and worship with us. Would you please stand and join us for praise and worship on this lovely spring-like morning?
We love to call. God that we serve. Do you believe it?
Yes, God.
Come on, let's go right here. Yeah. Let's celebrate the King with us. Jesus, we worship you. Yeah. When we call your name, can we testify right now and say, created from dust, you came and you lived among. You took on our frame, you walked in our pain, and now you're taking us high. How many of y'all want to go higher this morning? Come on. You stepped into time, yeah. You laid down your life to save us. You took all our shame. On the cross it was laid. And now you're taking us. Can you sing it out really loud? Say.
We go from glory.
Oh, yeah.
To glory.
Come on.
We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same.
We go from glory.
Yeah.
To glory.
We're forever changed. We're forever changed.
1, 2. You call me your friend. Everybody say,
you call me your friend.
Hallelujah. Brought us in.
Brought into your endless.
Come on, put some harmony on it right here.
By the blood I was made, no longer a slave.
Let's build it.
Now you're taking us.
Thank you, Jesus. So not even death can shake us. The victor has won, and heaven has come. And now you're taking us higher. Shout it this time. Everybody say,
now you're taking us higher.
We go from glory.
Yeah.
Just the drums. Would you help us? Really loud. We go. Let me hear.
We go from glory to glory.
Hey, come on.
To glory.
Say.
We'll never be the same.
No.
We'll never be the same.
Sing it again. Yeah.
You take us higher and higher.
Really loud.
Higher.
We're forever changed.
We're forever changed. We're forever changed.
We go from glory.
Thank you, Lord.
from glory to glory,
to glory to glory.
Can you sing it from your heart? We go from
glory to glory.
Thank you, Lord. Closer. You take us higher.
You take us higher and higher and higher.
We're forever changed.
We're forever changed. We're forever changed.
Hallelujah. We love you so much.
Thank you.
hallelujah belongs to you, yeah, yeah. My hallelujah, it belongs to you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, hallelujah. Lord, my praise belongs to you. Lord, my praise belongs to you and you only. Lord, the very fact that I breathe at this very moment is due to your grace. Lord, your grace, every good gift. Lord, every good gift comes from you, the good Father who is above. God, you are gracious. Lord, you give us the rain, you give us the sun. Lord, you protect, you guide, you safeguard, you save, you rescue, you reconcile, you shield. Lord, you're our shepherd, our rock, our fortress. Lord, my hallelujah. Lord, my hallelujah belongs to you only. Lord, you deserve it. Lord, you are worthy, and only you are worthy of our praise. Lord, we lift up our voice. Lord, we surrender our voice. We surrender our lives into the hands of the only one who deserves it. In your glorious, magnificent, beautiful name we pray, Jesus. Amen. 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 You may be seated. You may be seated. Church, it's so good to gather together with you this morning. I just want to steal a few minutes of your time to just kind of let you know a few of the things that are going on for us. We let you know this last week. I just want to remind you. Saturday, February 11th at 9 o'clock, right here in our building, we will have our first women's gathering. The men have had opportunity to meet a little bit more of that in a second, but we wanna give the women, we're excited to do this on Saturday, February 11th. There will be refreshments right here in our building. They'll meet downstairs. Wanna make sure that you're invited out to that. You already know this. I just want to remind you, I want to get this into your calendar. Every third Wednesday evening at 6 o'clock, again, right here in our building, will be the men's pizza night. So make sure that you got that on your calendar. It has been super fun. It's been awesome to observe what's happening in our children's ministry downstairs. It's just booming. There's so much good happening. There's so much teaching. There's so much pointing children towards our Lord. And we're just looking at just amplifying, just strengthening, just fortifying that team. So if you would prayerfully consider what it might look like for you to join that team perhaps once a month, we would love to have you do that. You can do that through Plug Me In. More of that in a second. Today, Pastor Kurt will just be out here in just a few moments, and he's gonna finish off, he'll close off our series on the Sermon on the Mount. And I just wanna direct your attention to next week. Next week, we'll kick off our next series, which will be going through the book of 1 Corinthians. We're excited excited about that. We're a church that preaches expositionally. That means we're walking through passages carefully, verse by verse, and we'll do that 1 Corinthians starting next week. If you were here around this time last year, you'll remember that we did a Wednesday night series called Understanding the Other. And we're about to get that going again. It's going to be a little bit different this year. We're doing a series called Loving Your Neighbor, right? It'll be the next 6 weeks. It'll replace our Bible study for the next 6 weeks. I want to invite you to that. We're doing it together with our partner church, which is Northbrook Church. And so we'll meet on Zoom. Again, all you need is our Zoom, our Bible study link, which you can find on our website. You'll be able to do that. But I want to invite everybody out to that, a series on loving your neighbor. I've mentioned Plug Me In several times. In the seat back in front of you, you'll have a card. And I just want to direct your attention to that. If you want to browse our affinity groups and see how you can join one of those, you can do that through here. The different ways you could plug in, you can do that through here. In the back, there's a way to set up giving. In the back, there's a way to to download our app so you can see all our sermons, know our calendar, know all the things that are going on. I want to just direct your attention to Plug Me In. Today is the first Sunday. And on first and third Sundays, we normally have our student ministry meet. But they were actually up in an all-nighter last night, starting at 7 p.m., going to 7 a.m. That picture was taken at 3 o'clock in the morning. You can't judge somebody at 3 o'clock in the morning. They look great. I do not look like that at 3 a.m., and so hats off to them. They're sleeping now the rest of the day away, and then we'll pick back up in student ministry the third Sunday this month, which will be February 19th. Pastor Kurt is going to jump up here in just a moment, but before he does that, would you just take a moment to greet someone around you?
Good morning. Welcome to You Flourish Church. My name is Kurt, serve as one of the pastors here at You Flourish Church. Excited to have all the wonderful faces here in the building on this morning. For those of you that know me, know most of the time I'm telling stories regarding sports. It's always basketball. But I will never forget the summer I spent playing baseball for my Boy Scout troop team. And our team, we made it to the championship game. And I wasn't that good at baseball, but I was still on the team. And I remember the game was tied. It was bottom of the ninth inning and two outs to go. Bottom of the ninth inning and we had had two outs and the game is tied, and we got a guy on second base, and it was my time to come up and to bat. And I can hear kids like snickering in the background, saying, "Oh my God, Kurt's going up to bat!" And then there was other kids that was trying to take the bat from me so they could go up and bat in my place because they just knew I was going to cost the team the game. And again, like, oh, I wasn't that good, but it was my turn. All right, and so I get up there, and wouldn't you know it, I mean, the first pitch that was thrown out, I swing, and I hit a double. I hit a double, y'all, yes. And the kid that was on second base, my teammate, he runs, and he makes it to home base, and all of a sudden, the game is over, and everybody's celebrating and congratulating my teammate that made it home. And I'm thinking to myself, like, well, when I make it to home base, that everybody's going to jump up on me. But what actually happened is, like, everybody ignored me. They congratulated the kid that made it from second base to home plate. And I didn't understand it. I was just really upset. I was really upset that day because I just felt like the glory that belonged to me ended up going to somebody else. Needless to say, I never played baseball again. Because I had a hard time reconciling the fact that even though I was directly responsible for the championship win, the glory I believed that I deserved, it went to somebody else. However, my experience pales in comparison to how often we take the glory that belongs to God and direct it towards something or someone else. And so as we close out Matthew 7 this morning, Jesus, he speaks to this very idea, highlighting two final principles he concludes his message on. And he gives us a concluding message on everyone declaring him Lord and everyone who hear his words. And we're going to begin by unpacking that first point of this concluding message on everyone declaring him as Lord. And we pick up in Matthew 7 this morning in the 21st verse. But before we go there, may we go to the Lord in prayer. God, you are good. We love you. We thank you for your mercy, for your grace, for your love, for your kindness. God, we pray above all that you would speak. And God, we pray that you will anoint our ears to hear everything it is that you would speak. And God, that you will anoint our hearts to apply everything it is that you would speak. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen. Picking up in verse 21, look at what it says. It says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. And if, for those of you that's following along this morning, I would like to bring to your attention in verse 21 and have you to highlight or underline, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom. And we have definitely made it to that part. It's that part. So here, Jesus, he moves from his statement about every tree not bearing good fruit would be cut down and thrown into the fire to now a concluding message about those without good fruit declaring him Lord. This is interesting. He had just made it absolutely clear about what it would look like if he had occupied the role of Lord in one's life. And essentially what he says on what we spoke on last year is like good fruit would be visible for those who are his followers. And so in verse 21, and he goes in and he proclaims after telling them that one would be known by their fruit, whether it be good or whether it be bad. He explained this very, very well as we began to look at chapter 7 on last week. And he concludes now, and he's bringing it all together. And I think one of the worst things that we could ever do is we could take the Sermon on the Mount and we divided it up. And of course, we had to divide it up because we can't preach it all in one sermon. But today, I want you to look at the Sermon on the Mount as a whole, as an entirety. And when we look at it as a whole and as an entirety, what he was saying about good fruit can be tied into what he's saying today, where he says that like every tree that does not bear, it didn't just say fruit. It says every tree that does not bear good fruit. How many like rotten fruit? Like we got some bananas in the office right now that look kind of black. We gonna be throwing them away tomorrow. Some people like, I like my bananas black. I like my bananas yellow. And apparently, this is what it is. And so he says, every tree that does not bear good fruit, he says, he's cut jot it down. And he says he throws it into the fire. And I know we talk about God and his mercy and his grace and his love and his kindness and all of that. It exists. It exists for everyone. It exists. Let me be clear about that. It exists. But I'm here to tell you there's something else that exists. There are those who refuse his love, his kindness, his grace, and his mercy. He offers it. Some refuse. And here's the thing. And so what he says is not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, to me will enter into the kingdom of heaven. And so this is an interesting thing. And so what he's talking about is not people that's like just out in the world. Like he's talking about people who actually practice church things. He's talking about people who look religious. He's talking about people who act religious. He's talking about people who call him Lord, but he ain't actually they Lord. This verse is a cause of much debate, you know, because some may be saying, well, I'm questioning, am I really saved? Can I lose my salvation? Am I expected to be perfect? Like all of those questions, I mean, they're valid. And I'm here to say, I don't believe that we can lose our salvation. I stand on that. I don't believe that we can lose our salvation if we have actually received salvation. Because when we receive salvation, something happens, something changes. We do not necessarily remain the same. We may not be perfect, and I'm not saying you have to be perfect, but you have to be perfect in love. And so when Jesus says, I want you to be perfect even as my Father is perfect, the Father is perfect in love. We operate as perfect in love. And we look at the Sermon on the Mount in its entirety. This is the message that Jesus is presenting, a message of love, not just loving the people that you like, not just loving people in your family and your friends and people who believe like you, vote like you, act like you, look like you. Jesus said, I want you to love some people who hate you. Like, this is where I want you to be perfect at. I want you to have a perfect heart, not being perfect in all of the things that I do, because the Lord knows that we've got some problems. Like, you can eat too many cookies. Like, and I'm guilty of that. But here's the thing. Jesus, he's declaring, everyone who says, Lord, 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 well, he only said it twice. I just added one. Everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will not, and like, man, this is tough. Will I lose? Again, I don't believe that we can lose our salvation. I believe when God gives it, he's not one who takes away. But I think we have to question ourselves, what is it that I've received? If I'm living a way outside of what my salvation says that I have to begin to start questioning some things. And this is why I love God and all of his mercy and all of his grace, because we have an opportunity to course correct. It's because I don't just receive him as my savior and don't allow him to occupy lordship in my life. This is why he said, you call me Lord. You've accepted me as Savior, but you're missing out on the point of the fact that I got to be your Lord. I can't be your Savior without being your Lord. You might call me Lord, but do I occupy the role as Lord in your life? And so while everyone has access to him as Savior, everyone does not submit to him as Lord. And so here's, again, the beautiful thing about his grace, his mercy, and his kindness is that he gives salvation. Everyone has it. You don't have to be all good. You don't have to be all knowing. You don't have to be all powerful. You don't have to be the best person in the world. You don't have to have great looks. Like, all of that. He's like, I give salvation to anyone who wants it. Salvation is available to all people. However, everyone does not submit to him as Lord. Now, he gives you the opportunity. He gives everyone has the opportunity to allow him to occupy lordship in their life. Unfortunately, everyone does not take him up on that offer. And so on that last day, this is what he's saying. He says, on that last day, people are going to understand that not everyone, and I love when he uses the language like everyone, but he says not everyone. I give salvation is available to everyone. But not everyone is going to accept what it is that I give. And in other words, it says what Jesus said in Matthew 15 and 8, when he says, this people, they honor me with their lips. but their heart is far from me. Y'all, I mean, this is the thing, and this is why my prayer, my hope, and my desire is that we can be a church, that we can be a church in this city that follows him with our heart. That we follow him, that our hearts would be representative of who it is that he is. That our city can begin to feel the love of Christ, because the love of Christ is what pours out of our heart. In the midst of challenges, in the midst of trials and tribulations, that our heart is representative of who Christ is. Like, my circumstances don't dictate my heart. That my heart remains consistent because Jesus is consistent. And this is why he says, protect your heart. Because out of it flows all of the issues of life. And when we start allowing our heart to be impacted by what the world and the world system, it's impossible for us to live like we got salvation. Subsequently, everyone honoring God again with their lips won't necessarily enter the kingdom. But Jesus, he makes it very clear who would. He makes it very clear in this passage. In the second part of verse 21, he says, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And this entails everything that we've read about in chapters 5-7 in the Sermon on the Mount. Ladies and gentlemen, we're closing the Sermon on the Mount today for chapters 5-7 in Matthew, but I want you to understand that this is one of the foundational pieces of what we believe in as a church. We're not teaching this message and just going on to the next thing in 1 Corinthians. Like, we're teaching this message because we're calling people in this church, in this city, to begin to start living out the teachings of Christ. Everything that we find, we're not going to say it's too difficult, it's too hard. These are the teachings of Christ. And when he gives us the Great Commission, he says, I want you to go to all people groups, to all nations. I want you to baptize, and I want you to teach them everything I commanded. We don't get to skip that part. And I'm talking to the charismatic church, the evangelical church. We don't get to skip the teachings of Jesus. I want you to look in the mirror, look at the teachings of Jesus, and to begin to start asking ourselves, how do I measure up? And so this is where Jesus said, like, I don't want you just to honor me with your lips. I don't want you to just give me worship. Like, we can worship in song, and I love worshiping in song. I love worship in prayer. I love worship in the word and all of those things. But our greatest form of worship is submitting our lives to his lordship. There is no greater worship than that. Like, Sunday morning worship is an event. I want you to understand that. This is an event. And I know y'all getting quiet. But let's be real. This is an event. And I said, like, how are you calling this an event? Yeah, we're coming together for fellowship. We're coming together for encouragement. We're coming together in many ways. This is also what I call discipleship. But what we do in this hour and a half service, that's just a very minute piece of our life. This hour and a half. How many hours is it in a week? I don't want to do the math. But when you think about how many hours it is in the week, outside of what we do when we're asleep, when we are awake, how much time do we spend worshiping God? And so this becomes our mirror, not to point at somebody else, not to point at your wife, not to point at your husband, not to point at the church folks sitting on the other side of the aisle, but this is a mirror for us. Jesus is, in all of his mercy and all of his grace and all of his kindness, he's prepping us for what our lives should be about. He's prepping us so we don't miss it on that day. He's prepping us. And Jesus, he wants us to understand that our spiritual life, that it must spill over into our daily walk. I want you to understand that we can't divorce one from the other. And John 15:8, Jesus, he says by this, my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. Like, I want you to understand, so this is what brings God glory. And we talk about what we want to do to bring God glory again. We sing, we preach, we do all of those things. But the greatest thing that brings God's glory, is the way in which we live. And again, tying back into what he says about a tree being known by its fruit, and tying back into the very message in the beginning that John the Baptist was the forerunner, that he comes and he creates a way before Jesus comes. And he said he's the one that comes. And he says, very, very in the beginning of the ministry, and we find in Matthew 3, John the Baptist says that every tree that does not bear fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. This is what John the Baptist says. When Jesus comes on the scene, Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Every tree that does not bear fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. Jesus says the exact same thing that John the Baptist says. And now what we see on the Sermon on the Mount, there's something to be said about this fruit, this bearing of fruit. And what we find in chapter 15, Jesus said, this is how my Father is glorified, that you would bear not a little fruit. He said, much fruit. He said that you will bear much fruit. He says, and prove to be my disciples. And this is really, really important. It's because he says you will know them by their fruit. It's very, very important. And so here's the thing. The day of judgment won't turn out so well for those who talk like Christians but live like devils. It ain't gonna go over so well. It just ain't gonna go over so well. And in verse 22, look at what verse 22 says. He says, on that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And cast out demons in your name? And do mighty works in your name? Oh. So this is really what gets difficult, because I hear people say, like, that church ain't got no power. Ain't no prophecy service going on over there. They ain't afraid of the demons. They ain't casting out demons. They running from demons over there. They ain't got no power. Like all of those things. And I ain't saying nothing is wrong with any of those things. Ain't nothing wrong with the gifts if you got the gifts. Unfortunately, the gifts don't get you into the kingdom. And we will find, because we're human and we'll follow people. Like, man, I want a powerful word tonight. The people don't read their Bible. They want a fortune teller. I need a fresh word today. Like, well, open up your Bible. There's a fresh word right there. But no, they want a fortune teller. And man, you can build a church through a prophecy service. And let me say, I'm not attacking prophecy. I believe in prophecy. I believe that I'm a walking example of what prophecy is. There have been some things prophesied in my life that I've seen, and I'm living it out today. So I'm a firm believer of the gift, but I want you to know that the gift can come from anybody. God can use anybody. If he can make an ass talk, he can make a devil prophesy truth. So what he's saying is, like, these people are going to come up before him. It's like, we've done these mighty things. We've even raised. And it used to be a point in time where I just thought the pinnacle of salvation, to me, I thought was raising somebody from the dead. I'm like, I am going to just get more of God and more of God and more of God until I can raise somebody from the dead, because Jesus said in his word that greater works we would be able to do. And I just held on to that so strongly and so strongly, because I thought that was the pinnacle of faith. And it would be great. I mean, if I had that gift, that would be definitely a mighty work. But according to this passage, I could raise somebody from the dead. And on that day of judgment, I can say, Lord, did I do mighty works in your name? And he says, I never knew you. And so what he's saying is what he said earlier. He says, you're going to know them by their fruit, not by their gifts. And so where he comes with this passage is he's adding on to that, as mighty as the works may look and as powerful as it may seem that the demons run. Because you speak, he's saying, that's not enough. And we can spend so much time being drawn to people with amazing gifts and with amazing works, but it's important. He tells us that we will know them. He says, beware of wolves, ravenous wolves in sheep's clothing, which he means like they don't look like a wolf. It means that you won't be able to identify them just on the outside or who is a wolf. He says, because they got on sheep clothing. He says, but you will know them by their fruit. The beautiful thing about that is it just doesn't give us the ability just to look at other people, but we will know ourselves by our fruit. It is also staggering to some that Jesus claims he's the one that they would be standing before. Imagine at this point in time, because right now, no one has declared Jesus as Lord. At this point in time, and here Jesus is, God the Son in the earth, telling a group of people, on Judgment Day, you're going to be standing before me. Imagine how staggering this is. And then there's probably some people that's there that's probably like, who does this cat think he is? What do you mean I'm going to be standing up before you? But what they don't realize is God the Son is standing right in front of them and letting them know, like, you're going to be standing right before me. And the good news in all of this is that although Jesus is speaking to a day of judgment, the day has not arrived yet. Like, this is the good news. You know, the bad news is not everybody going to make it in. The good news is you found out about it today. So you ain't quite aligned. Like, in all of God's grace and his mercy, we have an opportunity to course correct. We've got the opportunity to today, that's all, folks. We have an opportunity today to course correct. And this is why I love who God is. This is why I love him. Even though he is a God of judgment, he's a God of mercy and he's a God of grace. He's given us his word and all of his mercy. Jesus, he preps his followers on the ways in which the kingdom will test our submission to his lordship. And here's the thing. When I was in college, one of the things that I appreciated most, more than anything, you know, because in education, they love to give you just a bunch of tests to define how much you know. And really, test is really nothing about, but nothing more. It ain't about what you know. It's about what you remember. But I always love, you know, when the instructor would prepare you for the test. He's like, chapters 5 is what I want you to focus on most, because you're going to find that's going to be most of what's on the test. And I would pay close attention to the instructor and all of the notes that I was taking in class, because I wanted to be prepared for the test. I needed to know what it was that I needed to remember. And I took anatomy and physiology in a period of 4 weeks. Let me tell you, I didn't realize there was so much stuff in our body. There's a system for everything. And man, oh my God, all the veins and arteries. And yeah, I had to remember all of that stuff. But I paid close attention to what the instructor was preparing us for. Because what the instructor was preparing us for was going to be what was on the test. And this is why I love Jesus and all of his mercy and his grace, because he's preparing us for what's going to be on the test. And if you leave here today still saying, like, man, I want to see people cast out demons. I want to see people, like, ain't nothing wrong with the gifts. Trust me, ain't nothing wrong with the gifts. But that is not where people are going to enter into the kingdom. What's going to be on the test is the fruit, good fruit, much fruit, not spoiled fruit, not diseased tree. He don't want that stuff in the kingdom. He wants some. Subsequently, though, he makes it clear what is coming on the test, many will fail to enter through the narrow gate. And on that day, I want you to understand that Jesus, he never responds by telling them that they did not do great works. He never said, you didn't do great works. He never said, no, you didn't prophesy in my name. He didn't say, no, you didn't cast out demons in my name. Simply, he just says in verse 23, he says, then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. And on that day, let me just say, ladies and gentlemen, that salvation, it must go beyond confession and spiritual works. You've got to be known. Let me just say it. I know some people like, I got to understand it with Jesus. Like, we got to understand it. Me and God got to understand. You don't know my relationship. I got to understand. Well, the Bible says, I will get to know. He says, because I can know you by your fruits. So here's the thing. He says, I never knew you. And I want you to understand. I want you to pay very close attention to this, to knew. He says, I never knew you. And I want you to add it with what he says earlier. You will know them by their fruit. So that means that he knows he is by their fruit. There's no in between. There's no but. So will we be prepared for the test? And in Luke's version of the Sermon on the Mount, he says, every tree is known by its fruit. The second thing in the concluding message on the Sermon on the Mount, everyone who hear his words. He speaks a concluding message about everyone who hear his words. Picking up in verse 24, look at what it says. He says, everyone who then hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. But it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell. Everybody say it fell. And great was the fall of it. And when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teachings, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. Again, may the Lord add a blessing to the hearers and doers of his word. If you're following along, I want to bring to your attention in verse 24, everyone then who hears these words of mine. Here Jesus, he digs a little bit deeper into what it means to call him Lord, versus what it means to have him occupying the role of Lord in our lives. And let me say this, while everyone who calls him Lord may not necessarily cut the mustard, his message, it still applies to everyone. I want you to pay attention to the word everyone in this passage when you go back home and read it. There's something to be said about when he just continues to use this language, everyone. And in verse 21, Jesus says again, he says, in verse 24, I'm sorry, Jesus says, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. This is really key, because while hearing his words is necessary, hearing divorce from doing won't suffice. So it's good to hear his word, but hearing alone just won't cut the mustard. And so Jesus, he's speaking about what it means to be a wise man. It's important that we hear. In fact, Paul tells us in Romans 10 and 17, he says, faith comes by hearing. He says, and hearing through the word of Christ. But then James goes and tells us in James 2, he says, but faith without works is dead. And so we got to understand what it is that Jesus is trying to get his followers to understand. In fact, Jesus, he declared that those who hear and do his words are not only wise, but will flourish in all situations. And this is where it gets really beautiful, because again, Jesus, he's not just leaving us alone. He's not just saying on judgment day, or everybody going to hell. He's like, I'm prepping those who follow me or what it is they need to look for in their lives. And the beautiful thing is, like, you're not going to be alone today. I'm going to be with you. This is what he tells his disciples after he gives them the Great Commission. He says, I am with you always. You're not going to have to do it alone, but I want you to understand what it is that you have to do. And hearing and doing, it goes together like cookies and milk. I can't eat cookies without milk. I can't. Now, I learned the art of that at a very young age in kindergarten. I love kindergarten so much because I associated kindergarten with graham crackers and milk. Every time I went to school, I knew I was getting some graham crackers and milk. I just knew, you know, some things just go together. And this is something that goes together. Hearing and doing, it goes together. Hearing the words of God. And in fact, God, Jesus says, this is a wise man who builds his house on a firm foundation. And look at what he says in verse 25. And this is how we know it's firm. It's because in verse 25, he says, and the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And this is the beauty of it. This is the beauty of God's word, and this is the beauty of hearing it and doing it. Everything that we've heard in Matthew 5 and 7 up to this point, being the salt of the earth, being the light of the world, loving your enemies, blessing those who persecute you, all of those things that we've heard up to this point, he says, if you hear those things and you do those things, when the storms come, you won't fall. He says, why? Because you got a firm foundation. Your firm foundation is hearing and doing my word. Not just hearing only, but hearing and doing my word is the rock that your life has now been formed on. And so everything that comes your way, and there's going to be storms in your life. He said, the winds blew. Like when the winds blow and all hell is breaking loose in my family, I'm here to tell you I got a foundation. Family and friends may not understand why I won't get involved in certain things, but because I got a foundation. I cannot let that foundation dissipate. I'm holding on to it and I'm standing on it because guess what? This house ain't falling. I done been through enough hell in my life. I done had enough failure in my life. I done had enough heartache in my life. This rock ain't falling, I'm telling you. I'm saying I don't care what's going on. I'm holding on to what the word say. And the world has its own system. The world would point to its own system where if A happens, B should happen after. Well, if it does not agree with what Jesus says. Well, you know, you can't let people talk to you any kind of way. Well, where is it in the Bible that says I'm supposed to defend myself because people is talking about me a certain kind of way? Where? What scripture is that? Because I want to submit myself to it. Like all of these human things that we come up with to use as excuses for not submitting ourselves to what God says. And he says, this is the firm foundation. I want you to understand more than anything, we're concluding the Sermon on the Mount today. My prayer, my hope, my desire is that the people in here will begin to embrace it and to begin to live it out in your families, live it out in your friendships, to live it out because our city is failure in our city. There's failure in our country. And the only thing that's going to make the difference is the people of God. This is why he says we are the salt of the earth. This is why he says that we are the light of the world, because if we don't make the difference, if we don't make the difference, what are we doing? What are we doing? I want you to understand that the storms in your life is no match for the right foundation. And when Christ becomes our foundation for everything, every problem, and I don't know why, I just... The last week, I've been so caught up with conflict resolution. It has just evaporated my very soul. Because it's, and I don't understand. And the sad thing is it's conflict resolution among Christians. And it has just sapped all of the energy out of me. And I know the answer. I know what the answer is. The answer we find in God's word. It says, not only hear it, but to do it. If we submit ourselves to hearing it and doing it, there will be no, I shouldn't have to do conflict resolution unless I'm doing it with the world because they don't understand our system. I have to educate them about the system of Christianity. But for those of us who understand Christianity, we're not here for information. I hope we don't come here every Sunday so we can take a bunch of notes so we can have more information for our theological views. I don't care about anybody's theological view. I care about how it is that we're living, how it is that we're living out our faith. There's some power that resides in each and every one of us. The power of Jesus resides in it. And so Jesus, he's helping his followers to understand that everyone who hears his word and does them, he says it's like a wise man who builds his house. And I'm reminded of what it means to be founded on the power of the rock. And he talks about the seeds of the sower in Matthew 13. He talks about the seed being scattered along the path. And he says that, you know, the enemy comes and snatches away the little understanding that a person may have, so that word won't be taken form in their life. He said they hear the word, but the enemy comes and snatches it away because they don't have any understanding of it. He says there was some seed that was scattered along the rocky ground. He says that seed, he said they heard the word with joy. He says, and they received it. He says, but when testing and trials and persecutions came because of the word, he says they fell away because they didn't have any roots. They didn't have any root. Then he says there was some seed that was scattered among the thorns. And he says they received the word with joy. They received it. They heard it. They received it. They loved it. They embraced it. But he says then came the worries of this world, the seduction of riches and all of these other things. He said it came and choked the word out of their lives. And so when Jesus said, I want you to hear it. I want you to embrace it. I want you to do it. I want you to bear good fruit. And he says, this brings my Father glory. And it proves that you are his disciples. And it is better that we test the foundation of our life now rather than later. As Jesus compared the doers of his word to a wise man, he also compares the non-doers of his word to a foolish man. In verse 26, look at what it says in verse 26. He says, and everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. Merely hearing God's word again isn't enough to provide a secure foundation. And interestingly, both houses look identical on the outward. But the manner of foundation is what sets the difference. But foundation is not as visible until the storm comes. You know, when there's no storms, both houses look just alike. But when the storms come, it identifies what manner of foundation it is that you have. And this is why Jesus says, he's like the foolish man. He builds his house on the sand. Who does Jesus call the foolish man? The person who hears the word of God and does not do them. He says that is a house that's built on sand. And so again, when the storms of life begin to start raging, first thing we do, we're like, I don't want Jesus no more. I'm going to handle this with these. I'm going to handle it some other kind of way other than the way like Jesus. And in verse 27, Jesus, he speaks again to this house that's built on sand. And in verse 27, he says, and the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat against the house and it fell. And it didn't just fall, but he says, and great was the fall of it. And so here's the thing that, so I mean, you can build a house and you can put like the best doors on the house. It has amazing doors and beautiful windows, you know, the kind that flip all kind of ways for you to clean it and they double pane and all that. And you can have the best flooring and you could have like marble countertops. You could have a man cave out of this world. Like you can have all of those things. And it's like when the storm comes, you can put invested all that money on the outside and on the things that don't matter. And when the storms come, it said great was his fall. And I'm going to tell you why it was great, because we invested so much into the inward things of it. He says great is that fall. And what would it look like if hearing and doing the words of Jesus became the foundation of our lives? What would that look like in the lives of each and every one that's sitting here today? And he closes this passage In verse 28 and 29, Matthew writes, he says, and when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching. Verse 29 says he was teaching as one who had authority and not as their scribes. And it's interesting. Yes, they were astonished because at that point in time, this was not the popular teaching, what Jesus was teaching. Unfortunately, even today, this ain't the popular teaching. It's sad, really. But the fact that we separate what he did from who he is, that we separate what he did from the role that he occupies in our life. Now, I want you to understand who it is. He is the one who looked down from his throne and saw a people who couldn't seem to get it right. There were 613 Old Testament laws that nobody could get right. And if you failed at one, you were guilty of them all and you were cast to like eternal damnation. And so he looks off of his throne and says, like, I got to come and I got to pay a price to redeem lost people. He comes off of his throne. He comes into the earth. He suffers. He suffers a grueling death, a grueling death. Everything that he taught us, he lived out. He exemplified in the way that he lived it out. Everything that he taught. And so he came and he paid a price for you and I to have salvation. And the one thing that we have today, we have his Holy Spirit that lives in us when we accept him as our Lord and our Savior, and we have his word. What will we do with the spirit that he indwells in us and the word that he's left us? Will we make a change in our lives? And if you haven't taken that step today, if you haven't taken that step yet today, you can. Romans 10 and 9 tells us if you confess Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart God has raised Jesus from the dead, you shall have salvation. Salvation could be yours today. And my challenge to you is that as we close out Matthew 5 and 7, that you begin to allow that to be the foundation of your lives, that we live it out, that we live it out. When the storms come, that we live it out. Let us pray. God, you are good. We love you. We thank you for your mercy, for your grace, your love, your kindness. God, I pray right now, God, that you would touch the hearts and minds and thoughts of each and every one that's here today, God, that we would make a difference in our families, in our communities, God, in the workplace, God, in our marriages, in our parenting, God, that we can be the difference, God. Father, we're praying that your word will arrest us. Do it right now, God. For your glory's sake, God, you said for your glory, God, that it is required of us to bear much fruit, God. And we know without you, we could do nothing, God. And so, God, we desire to abide in you as you abide in us so that we may produce much fruit in the earth, God, that we may be salt, that we may be light. God, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Jesus, who died for us, had some powerful words to instruct us. If his death and his resurrection pierced you today, or if his words, his instructions pierced you today, and you would like the opportunity to pray with somebody, Deanne and William and Laura are all over here, and they would love the opportunity. They'd be honored to spend a few moments just praying together with you as we transition to a time of giving, as we transition to this time of offerings. It's very important to us, the motivation of the heart. We don't want you to feel guilted. We do not want you to feel pressured. We want this to be an overflow of your walk with Christ. Here at You Flourish, there are three ways that you are able to give. You can text a dollar amount to the number 84321. You can go to our website through our Plug Me In card and do it that way. And we want to, however you're going to go about that, we want to invite everybody into this third way. Into you'll have the opportunity to give personally. I'm going to invite the ushers forward. There will be two ushers up here. And then row by row, they will dismiss you to come forward. And so we ask that you would come down the center aisle and then return to your seat via the side aisles. And I will now leave you in the auspice of our ushers.
I think this song that we're about to sing is the perfect song to wrap up this message. Let the words minister to your heart today. Thank you, Jesus. And are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling you. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. This morning he's calling us. Come on, church. Let's go.
Oh, come to
Jesus.
The altar.
Father's arms.
The Father's arms.
He's available. Forgiveness.
Forgiveness.
Was
born with
precious.
The precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Ah, yes, yes. Come on, let's change it. I'm not looking back anymore. Leave behind your regrets. Harmony.
Leave behind your regrets and mistakes.
Come today,
there's no reason to wait.
Jesus is calling. Oh, bring your sorrows. Come on. Bring your sorrows
and trade them for joy.
From the ashes.
Jesus is calling.
Once you've given, would you please stand to your feet? Oh, come to. Let's worship the Lord today. Come on. Let's press in.
The Father's.
Yeah.
There is forgiveness.
And it was born with
the precious blood.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Sing it again. Oh, come to the altar.
Oh,
presence. We sing the highest praise. We say hallelujah. And we say,
oh, what a Savior.
Isn't he wonderful?
Isn't he wonderful?
Let's lift our voices, church.
Sing hallelujah.
Christ is
risen.
Ooh. All we need is you, God.
Bow down before.
Is the Lord over all.
For he is Lord of all.
Sing hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
Let's go in harmony. Dig in. Come on. Here we go. Say,
oh, what a Savior.
Isn't he wonderful? Thank you, Lord. Let's sing.
Forgiveness.
Let's go one more time.
Was born with.
Yeah. Sing it out, church.
Oh, won't you
come to the altar?
The Father's arms.
There is forgiveness.
Was born with.
precious blood.
The precious blood of Jesus.
Blood. Yeah. Let's just give him just a few seconds of worship. Come on, in your own way, in your own way. Hallelujah. With your own fruit. The fruit of your lips today. Come on, worship him. Yeah. Hallelujah. We want to bear good fruit, Jesus. Yes.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Can we just worship him? Can we just worship him? Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Isn't he wonderful?
Hallelujah, he's wonderful.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
Yes, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Bow down before. Bow down before.
Hallelujah. Bow down before Jesus.
For he is Lord.
You are Lord Jesus.
And we sing hallelujah.
Just break it down.
Oh, what a Savior.
What a Savior. What a Savior.
Isn't he wonderful?
Hallelujah. He's wonderful, Jesus.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
Yes, Lord Jesus. You are worthy, Jesus. You are worthy, Jesus. You are worthy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. Well, we thank you so much for coming by to worship with us on this morning. Normally, for those of you who may be new here, we normally go into a time of a Q&A session. I don't know what time it is, but so I'm going to bypass it. If you have any questions, you can text your questions to the number that's probably behind me. It will be behind me. There's a number. There it is, yeah. You can text your questions to that number. Pastor Ronaldo and myself would be happy to answer your questions. I know this message was probably, it's a tough one because we're talking about the Day of Judgment. So if you have any questions whatsoever, we don't want you to not have those questions answered. So we encourage you to text your questions in. We love you with the love of God. Thank you again for coming by to worship with us. With that being said, we're going to go ahead and dismiss you. May the Lord watch between me and thee while we're absent one from another. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.